and it was this solution that may have saved the Allies in North Africa. On Auchinleck's instructions, the 8th Army positioned itself along a 40-mile length of desert front, with the sea to the north and the impassable Qattara Depression to the south. At this time, the Egyptian capital city of Cairo was convulsed in panic. German conquest seemed inevitable. But General Auchinleck knew that if Rommel was going to get to Cairo, he would have to attack the Allied 8th Army directly. The Qattara Depression ruled out the possibility of an outflanking maneuver. In July 1942, the Panzer Armee repeatedly attacked the British line in attempts to break it. But despite heavy casualties, the 8th Army line held, and Auchinleck ordered a counterattack, which was itself repulsed as the desert shook with the full force of war. Despite a succession of fierce engagements, by the end of the month, the fighting had died out, as both exhausted armies consolidated their positions. The Allies' defences were organised into individual fortifications, or boxes, along the length of the front. The most substantial was located around a small coastal settlement called El Alamein. The fighting that took place here in July 1942 is now referred to as the First Battle of El Alamein, but this is not the engagement that is best remembered today. General Auchinleck saw that by establishing defences at El Alamein, Rommel would not be able to use his preferred outflanking manoeuvre. But in London, there was grave concern about the situation in North Africa. The loss of Tobruk was seen as a national humiliation, and although Cairo had been saved, Churchill decided that changes of leadership were needed again in North Africa. On the 4th of August, the British leader arrived in Cairo to inspect the desert situation for himself. For General Auchinleck, it was a fateful visit. Churchill's expedition to the desert convinced him that he should be replaced. Within days, two new men were appointed to take over the responsibilities of Auchinleck. At this point, the British commanders of the Battle of El Alamein took to the stage. Lieutenant General Bernard Montgomery formally took over as commander of the British 8th Army on the 13th of August 1942. Within 3 months, he was a military legend whose name would be forever associated with one Egyptian battlefield. But Montgomery was not the first choice for the command that made his name. Montgomery was originally due to take charge of the British 1st Army for the imminent Allied landings in northwest Africa, Operation Torch. The 8th Army was allocated to General William Gott. When Churchill visited Egypt in early August 1942, he was impressed by Gott's command of the British 13th Corps and concluded that he was ready for an army command. But fate dictated that William Gott was denied the chance to make himself a legend. On the 6th of August 1942, Gott received his new appointment as commander of the British 8th Army. The following day, he took off from Cairo in a Bristol-Bombay transport plane. His destination was the front at El Alamein. But William Gott never reached his destination. Whilst in flight, his aeroplane was ambushed by a squadron of Luftwaffe fighters, forcing the pilot to crash in the desert. Gott escaped from the wreckage, but others remained trapped inside. When the British general attempted to rescue them, the transport plane blew up, killing the newly appointed army commander. Hours later, the commander of the Southeast Army was informed of his new command. Following the tragic death of William Gott, Bernard Montgomery was appointed commander of the 8th Army in Africa. Born in 1887, Bernard Law Montgomery joined the Royal Warwickshire Regiment in 1908 and was already a platoon commander by the outbreak of World War I. Having been wounded twice and awarded the DSO, by 1918 he'd risen to the rank of Divisional Chief of Staff. He'd also acquired a profound distaste for the carnage that characterised the fighting on the Western Front. When hostilities resumed in 1939, Montgomery was appointed commander of the 3rd Division sent to France, and he was closely involved with the successful evacuation of British forces at Dunkirk. He'd now acquired the nickname Monty, and he cut a distinctive figure with his trademark two-badge beret. By 1942, Monty had become one of the most recognisable faces in the British Army. By the end of the war, he was a national hero. A grand title also awaited Montgomery's superior in Africa, General Sir Harold Alexander. Born in 1891, Alexander first revealed his talents as an officer during the grim fighting of World War I. By the time war broke out again in 1939, he'd risen to the rank of Major General, and he was given a divisional command in the British Expeditionary Force sent to France. It was the beginning of a brilliant war. At Dunkirk, Harold Alexander was also deeply involved with the amazing evacuation of the British Army almost from under the noses of the Germans. A senior command in the jungles of Burma followed, before Churchill appointed him Commander-in-Chief of British Middle East Forces in August 1942. The relationship between Alexander and Montgomery was crucial in the preparation and execution of the El Alamein offensive. Thankfully for the Allies, the two men got on extremely well. Montgomery also enjoyed an excellent relationship with the commander of the Desert Air Force, Air Vice Marshal Sir Arthur Cunningham. The two men agreed that air forces and ground troops needed to work together if strategic objectives were to be achieved. As proof of this, Cunningham placed his headquarters next to Montgomery's in the Egyptian desert. Although it was a practical decision, it was unprecedented at the time, and it symbolized the fusion of land and air power that Montgomery could call on. His German counterpart did not enjoy such a close relationship with his much smaller air force, but his reputation as a military leader led many to believe that he could triumph, whatever the odds. Field Marshal Erwin Rommel has always been one of the best-known figures of the Second World War. A charismatic figure with a strong personal presence, Rommel was born in 1891, and like so many of his generation, saw active service in the First World War. A true hero, Rommel was awarded Germany's highest award for bravery in the course of the conflict. And by the beginning of World War II, he'd risen to the rank of Major General. In 1940, as commander of the 7th Panzer Division, Rommel led a devastating German advance to the coast of the English Channel, earning a Knight's Cross in the process. Shortly afterwards, he became the youngest field marshal in the German army. The German field marshal was convinced of his abilities as a leader, and by 1942, Rommel compared his skills to those of the Fox. Almost as soon as he arrived in Africa, he acquired the nickname by which he is still known today. The Desert Fox. But Rommel was not so positive about his colleagues' talents. The structure of the Axis Command in North Africa meant that the Desert Fox had to answer to the commander-in-chief of all German forces in the Mediterranean region, Albert Kesselring. Born in 1889, Albert Kesselring first trained as a gunner, but by the end of World War I, his talents had secured him a place on Imperial Germany's General Staff. In the 1930s, he joined the young Luftwaffe, and by 1939, he was a Luftflotte commander during the invasion of Poland. Kesselring enjoyed a similar command during the Battle of Britain, and despite the German defeat, his career progressed with his appointment as German Commander-in-Chief South. Later on in the war, Kesselring sealed his reputation as a leader with his imaginative defense of the Italian peninsula. But in Africa, his contribution was less impressive. His subordinate, Rommel, grew convinced that Kesselring was not prepared to commit sufficient air power to the North African campaign, and the Allied advantage in the air proved to be a decisive factor in the Battle of El Alamein. But on the ground, the Panzer Armee Afrika was a powerful force, an army of conquest led by a cult-like figure who was virtually worshipped by the men under his command. When Montgomery arrived in Africa, he was alarmed to find that many of his men were obsessed with Rommel and more interested in his next move. Montgomery moved quickly to curb this fascination, but also made his own contribution to the Rommel legend. In his